Ladies, it's your time to shine with all things fabulous with First for Women on Afternoon Express. For insurance with a host of fabulous benefits, call 0861 11 1844 or SMS FIRST to 49267.
Today on Afternoon Express, hip-hop artist Riky Rick joins us in the loft. Model and professional surfer Roxy Louw chats about her career. We discuss anger management with life coach Warren Munitz. Explore new trends in dog therapy. We chat to the creators of South Africa's latest hit comedy film, Stone Cold Jane Austen. And in the kitchen, we satisfy your sweet tooth.
Good afternoon, South Africa. Lovely to have you back right here on Afternoon Express on SABC3. I'm Bonang Mateba. Hopefully you're ready for another hour of inspiration and pure entertainment like we do it every single day right here on the lot. We've got some fantastic entertainment coming up your way and awesome guests. Starting off with South African rapper Riky Rick. He's in the loft with us today. And of course, actress, model and professional surfer Roxy Louw. Going to be chatting to her a little bit later. Also in the loft, we're going to be chatting to John Savage and Rob from Fearin. So much to do, so little time. But as you all know, it's not the Afternoon Express without some food. But before we go to Bonnie, just a quick reminder to make sure that you interact with us. We love hearing from you. You know exactly where to find us at Afternoon Chat on Twitter using our official hashtag, hashtag Afternoon Express. All right, so today we're doing it very, very sweet, but Bonnie has all the details in the kitchen.
Sweet indeed, B. Welcome back to the Loft Kitchen. I'm Bonnie Mbuli, and trending in the kitchen today is Italian desserts. And joining me is Woolies product developer in charge of desserts, Marli Roberts. Welcome to the show.
Great. Nice to be back.
And today we're making roasted figs with orange zest and brown sugar, right?
That's correct.
Sounds so yummy. I can't wait. But for now, let's cozy in up on the couch with Bonang and our first guest, Riky Rick.
Thank you so much, Bonnie. Let's get the show on the road. We're not wasting any time today. He's one of my favorite South African rappers. Has a brand new album titled Family Values. And he's somebody that's made a name for himself, you know, with his lyrics talking about growing up in the most brutal parts of South Africa. He's done so much all the way from Kwamashu in KwaZulu-Natal. Riky is in the loft. Welcome to Afternoon Express.
Thank you. That's the greatest intro I ever had.
Oh, beautiful. Darling. You know how I roll. I mean, I was with you and interviewing you on Metro FM a couple of, you know, weeks ago, and now you're here. And so much has happened. Yeah. Being from Kwamashu, my very first question has to be, I know we've all seen the xenophobic attacks that have been happening that started in Kwamashu and obviously spreading around the country. Yeah. You being from there, how has that made you feel, the whole experience?
It's crazy because, you know, we left Kwamashu when I was about seven. And, you know, the main reason why we were leaving was because there was so much violence around about that time.
Okay.
And so we've sort of been detached from actually the type of environment, you know what I mean?
Mm.
And to see things like this happening again, it's really like, yo, some people are still going through the same thing, whether it's 94 or xenophobic attacks now.
Yeah.
It's still, it's still really rough for some people out there.
Yeah, it really is. But let's talk a little bit about your brand new album, Family Values.
Yeah.
You know, what kind of person do you think, you know, you targeted this particular album too, and you know the kind of person you'd like to listen to Family Values.
I don't know. Some people say that I sort of tricked the public.
Yeah.
Because I gave them all these dance songs, happy songs. Everyone was jumping up and down, and then I did the Family Values album, which is really like a reflection of my life and reflection of like really serious issues that I've been through and stuff that I've trying to overcome and still overcoming today.
Mm.
So it's almost like I've been getting like messages from people saying that, you know, they cry when they hear this certain song because I've got songs about, I've got songs about overcoming addiction. I've got songs about, living through fatherless homes. I've got songs about losing friendships that you thought you would have forever. So people were really not expecting that type of stuff. And now that when they listen to it, they get the biggest shock. It's almost like an uppercut, but it's like an emotional uppercut, you know?
Yeah.
So I've been really happy. I've been really happy with the response because, like, you know, when you put your truth on an album or music of some sort, you open yourself up to criticism of your music. But when your music is your soul, it's a difficult thing, you know?
Yeah,
what I mean?
And music is your soul, and you've relied on yourself to get the music out there. I mean, I follow you on Instagram, and seeing you at shows and traveling all across the country, you're taking your music with you, and you're actually selling it outside of the boot of your car. Why that decision?
You know, it's a new. There's no more rules. You know what I mean? Like, we're independent artists. Like me and some of my friends, we decided to sort of take this journey independent. And the whole thing about being independent is that we have to try all the different avenues of getting people on music that haven't been tried yet. That might not be acceptable to major companies. So with the thing of pushing out my boot, like I said, for the next 2 months after my album drops, I need to make sure that at least all my fans get an opportunity to hear it. I've got people in the Free State and people in outside areas from the main markets that are unable to go to a store and get the album because it might cost them $100 just to get to the store.
True.
So the best thing is that, you know, while I'm there in the city, I might as well have 200, 300 CDs and take it to them and they'll be able to share the joy.
And what I love as well about your fans is that they've interacted and really taken this family values approach to social media.
Yeah.
Posting pictures on Instagram with their family, hashtag family values.
Yeah, yeah.
Did you think that would go that viral? Like people all over the country coming together, taking a picture, tagging you and hashtagging family values.
Yeah, it's crazy because I checked actually yesterday, I was checking, and the whole thing about it is that the term family values is not actually an African term or South African term. It's not familiar to South Africans. So before I did it, I checked like all the hashtags and they were all like American, because Americans use the term family values a lot.
Uh-huh.
And now it's like I see people from, you know, from the Eastern Cape, from Venda, people from Polokwane, and it's like it's a complete shift on social media that I'm seeing. And like I'm really happy. Like, you know, some people aren't really like you might not ashamed. I won't say people are ashamed, but it's like as young people having children and having young families, we might not be the best at that. So we don't advertise that we have children or have families because you know we might not be the best. So
to see
people taking pictures with their families and their little kids and their brothers and sisters, it's really amazing.
And let's talk about your family. You have a little boy and you wrote a song Sondela for your girlfriend, mother of your child. Why? That's, you know, was it a paying homage to her, saying thank you for this amazing gift? Because anybody that knows Riky knows that you are obsessed with your 13-month-old son.
Definitely. And thank you for saying mother of your child and not saying baby mama.
Yeah, no, I don't like that term, baby mama.
She's tired of people saying baby mama. Like I say, like, for me, I might only get one opportunity to put on an album.
Yeah.
This might be my only opportunity tomorrow. I don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. And while I still have the opportunity to make music that really reflects the things I'm going through is the most important thing. So a song like Sondela was really like a no-brainer for me because it was just all the emotions I tried to take out in real life that I might not be able to. I have to try put it on a song, and that's what happened.
Yeah, and for anybody that's watching, Sondela means come closer.
Come closer, yeah, come closer.
Yeah,
come closer.
I love that. And I mean, your baby's on the cover of your album.
Yeah.
Family
yeah.
Values. Apart from him being so adorable, how has he impacted your music and your life?
It's like I used to curse a lot, so there's a lot of four-letter words in my vocabulary, and like there was a lot of intensity whenever there was an important phone call.
Okay.
Now it's almost like the home environment. I understand what it's built for. You know what I mean?
Okay.
It's really a relaxed and chilled time to spend time with those kids. So he's sort of just like. It created like a mold of what my life should be going forward.
Yeah. And you always say now that it feels like you have a purpose.
Yeah.
You're working towards something.
Yeah.
And what's next for Riky Rick?
Next up, I don't know. Like, you know, I'm just trying to take things, you know, step by step. But what I do know is that I want people to sort of be inspired by maybe my story and people to find out my story. I don't want people to think that, yo, it's the guy you see on TV or on the movies or whatever. I want people to research my story and find something that they can relate to, because I believe that, you know, all of us are sort of going through the same things.
Absolutely.
But we might distance ourselves from other people because we're scared of the shame, maybe.
All right.
Yeah.
I have a gift for you.
Oh.
I can just find it.
Oh, presents.
Somewhere here.
Oh.
I've hidden it. Somewhere here.
Just
all right.
Sure. Wow.
So, we have remixed the cover of your album, Family Values. You are now part of the Afternoon Express family, and there I am, there's Bonnie Mbuli, and there's Jeannie D. So the deluxe version, ladies and gentlemen, of Family Values. There you go. If you miss us, you can just, I mean, pop it right there.
Wow. And you guys are in a little cozy blanket also. Wow.
Yes. So there you
amazing.
Go.
Amazing.
Thank you very much for sticking
Thank
around.
You. Thank
if you want to hear that brand new single, Sondela, Riky Rick is going to be performing it right here in the loft. So make sure you don't go anywhere. What I'd like to know, right, is what are some of your family values? Let us know right now on Twitter, @AfternoonChat, #AfternoonExpress. It's all about the sweet tooth. We're going to get down and dirty and cooking with Bonnie after the break. Stay tuned.
Welcome back to Afternoon Express on SABC3. In the kitchen again, and it's all things syrupy sweet and Italian. Marli, what's the first step with our figs?
Well, today we're doing a nice citrus roasted fig. So we're just going to cut them in half. And if you can help me, we'll do it just from the top to the bottom. Okay. And we'll put it on the tray. And then I'll go ahead and I'll start mixing the topping, okay, which is just some of this brown demerara sugar. We've also crushed some amaretto biscuit, which is an Italian almond biscuit.
Oh, wow.
That gives a little bit of a bitter taste, and you get that nice nuttiness from the almonds.
Right, you said demerara sugar.
Yeah. Demerara is, well, always, it looks as if there's ants in there, it moves.
Oh, yes.
It's a softer brown sugar, but it gives a lovely, rich flavor, and it also melts quite nicely once you put it on top of a dish that you'll put into the oven.
Okay.
Yeah.
And I see you've brought a whole range of Italian desserts. What's your favorite here?
Right now, for me, it is the crostata.
Okay.
That's sitting there next to you. I think because it's so nice and rustic, we use semolina flour in the pastry, mm-hmm, which makes it nice and short. And right, then the crostata, the first time it was noted in a recipe book was in the early 14th century in an Italian recipe book. And it just refers to a free-form pastry or pie that you make with any fresh fruit that's in season.
Oh, wow.
So...
And that's going to accompany our figs?
Yes, okay, yes. If you want to perhaps pass me those crostatas as well,
for
we'll
sure
finish this up just now.
Can we use any other fruit besides figs?
Yeah, so you can use any fruit that's in season. Mm-hmm. And it just has to be quite a harder fruit that can go into the oven.
Okay.
That won't go soft when you roast them.
Right.
Yeah. These crostatas will only go in for about 7 to 8 minutes. When you heat them up, you can also serve it cold should you wish to do that.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, and then back to the figs, we're just going to take this crumb mixture, and I'm just going to use my hand, and then we... sprinkling
it
over.
Yeah, this is a very quick and easy dessert.
Yeah, it's lovely. You can either have it on its own, and we'll make a nice cream to go with it as well.
And if you'd like to cook along with us, please go to our website, www.afternoonexpress.co.za, for the full recipe and shopping list.
And then I'll squeeze some orange juice over.
Okay.
And we'll just finish off with a drizzle of honey.
Okay, wow. So orange zest is the actual rind?
That's the rind.
Okay.
And you just make sure that you don't get the pith in, because the white part of the skin tends to be quite bitter.
Yes.
And that's it. And then we can put it straight into the oven.
Awesome. Thank you, Marli. So while we pop those in the oven, let's head back to B, who's joined by hottie and surfer Roxy Louw.
Thank you so much, Bonnie. Today on the show, as you all know, we are celebrating awesome families, awesome family values. Riky Rick is still on the culture theme. But right now, joining me in the loft is professional surfer, model, actress, and of course, daughter of the South African rugby legend, Rob Lowe. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Roxy Louw onto Afternoon Express. Lovely to have you. Of course, ushered in by Werner. Thank you very, very much. Roxy, welcome.
Hi.
Have a seat. How are you doing?
Good, thanks.
Lovely to see you. You know, the one thing I love about Afternoon Experience is that I finally get to interview the people that I've admired after so many years. I've always wanted to ask you this question. You've traveled the world, obviously, as a professional surfer. How did that journey start for you? How did you get into surfing?
Yeah, it was quite strange. I played provincial hockey. So I was a hockey player, so I've always had that competitive edge.
Yeah.
And then from hockey, it kind of went... Yeah, I picked up a board one day on holiday and started surfing, and it just bit me in.
And then that was
it. And that's where it went, yeah.
You seem to kind of stumble into successful careers, Roxy. After that, you then went into modelling. Obviously, you were a surfer first. How were you discovered? Was it the year of FHM? Who found you and found your love for modelling?
Well, the modelling came after the surfing. So the surfing, I was competing, and Oakley picked me up. So I went on a surf trip to Brazil.
Uh-huh.
And from that, a photo was taken, which ended up random, no makeup, nothing.
Yeah.
Ended up being the international campaign for the year. So
that's
kind of how the modeling kind of, you know, went about.
Yeah. I mean, on the show today, I mean, you know, we spoke to Riky earlier about family. And obviously your father, as we all know, is a legend, a rugby legend, Rob Lowe. Did he have, obviously, an impact on you getting into sport? And did he influence your choices as to which sport you chose?
He was quite strange, yeah. I'm the first oldest of four kids, so we've all had a bit of pressure on us from my dad, not from my dad specifically, but from, you know, just when I was playing hockey, for example, everyone around the hockey field would always say, Roblo's daughter's playing. So you always have that external pressure. And if you walk in a shopping mall, I remember as a child, people would, you know, kind of say that's Rob's daughter.
Okay.
So there's always been that pressure, but at the same time, I suppose, you know, I could caddy for him and go to golf days.
But, you know, Riky, if your son had to say, Dad, I want to be a rapper, I want to follow in your footsteps, what would you say to him if he wants to get into the entertainment industry or, like Roxy, you know, receive that external pressure from the world to follow in dad's footsteps?
Yeah, I think I'd have to allow him to do it, you know what I mean? Mm. Like, my dad didn't pressure me into doing anything, so I'd have to sort of give him the same respect, you know what I mean? He'll do his own thing.
But you know, black families are always like, you must go to school, you must become a doctor, you must become a policeman. Did you get it? Because I did. They do not understand entertainment at all.
Yeah, I'd love him to be a lawyer or a doctor.
or a surfer.
But please be a lawyer, doctor first, and then if you're good at that stuff, go and do it. But he's going to be able to do whatever he wants. It's going to be good.
Fantastic. But Roxy, I follow your blog. And in the one post, you were very open about how your father was diagnosed with melanoma. And you went on, and then you studied nutrition and health. It opened up this world and fascination for you. You know, how was that diagnosis? Did it impact your career, as a person?
We're a very close family. So my mom and dad are still together. And, I mean, when the news came out, my dad's the healthiest person, you know, obviously with rugby, and he's always been healthy. And then, you know, the news came out that he had melanoma. One day he got home, told us, guys, listen, first of all, I've got cancer. Second of all, it's not going to affect me. We're going to take this head on.
Yeah.
So I was like, okay, you know, dad's positive attitude. And through his nutrition, you know, he had his cells removed. Mm. His T cells were put on ice. So if it ever comes back, they can inject it back into him.
Yeah.
But at the moment, they've just cut out the melanoma. And they gave him 3 months to live after they diagnosed him. And from that, he's literally just kept it at bay with his nutrition. So his diet is, you know, touch wood, kept him alive. And it's 5 years later.
And he's still healthy and
happy. He's healthy and happy. So just from that alone, it kind of sparked an interest in nutrition.
But I mean, you come from a very fascinating family, and everybody in your family is quite strong. I mean, your grandfather, right, is 93, and he's the oldest person alive who was born on Robben Island. I mean, hello, Roxy. I mean, hello.
Cape Town, proper Cape Townian.
That's fantastic.
Yeah, my opa. Yeah, he turned 93.
Yeah.
Yeah, so.
But does he share any experiences with you, you know, living, being born in Robben Island? How was it? Yes. What does he talk about?
Yeah, no, he's quite old now. So, from the stories that he told me, it's now a little bit, you know, a bit hazy when it gets to the stories. But yeah, he fought in World War II.
Mm-hmm.
His mother was a nurse on Robben Island at the time during the leprosy. And so he was born there, and dad came about. Dad's healthy, mom.
Yeah. What is the one value that you think kind of, you know, keeps your family together? What is the foundation? Wow. I know it's love. Love is always there, but what else?
Love is, of course, but I mean, being humble and just realizing that, you know, we've got each other and everyone's on the same level. My dad's always said, I've got four kids. Rox, you're the oldest, but it doesn't mean that you can boss the youngest around.
Yeah.
You know, so it's everyone just being on even terms.
Fantastic.
And yeah, it's we're all very close. So.
That's awesome. So how did they feel that you were one of the sexiest women in the world?
I wanted to say that I used to actually have a poster of hers on my wall at boarding school.
From FHM?
I think it was the Sports Illustrated edition. I had the poster in boarding school, so now I'm here, you know what I mean?
Like, You made it, Riky.
How does it feel?
I mean, I've loved you. Riky had a poster of you, and here we are all sitting together. Do you get pressure to kind of live up to the expectation of being Sports Illustrated, FHM, sexy, Roxy?
You know, I'm kind of in a haze. So when I hear things like this, it's quite surprising to me myself. But we did shoot together. We had a back-to-back black and white shoot.
I remember. I was like, I have made it.
I think it was one of your first shoots ever.
Ever for FHM. It was fantastic. Yeah. And to sit here with you is really awesome. So thank you so much for coming here and sharing your story. Super. I hope you guys stick around. Make sure you don't go anywhere. Riky and Roxy are going to hang out in the loft with us right here on Afternoon Express on SABC3. After the break, we tackle anger issues. Warren Munitz is going to be chatting to us straight after the break. Don't move.
South Africa, are you with us?
Welcome back to Afternoon Express on SABC3. Now, the hustle and bustle of our everyday lives can leave us feeling so frustrated and tottering on the verge of anger all the time. It can lead to road rage, to fighting with our partners and our children, and leave us emotionally drained. But joining us today is Warren Munitz, who shares with us some advice on how we can control our anger. Welcome back, Warren. It's great to have you.
Thanks for having me.
What are the major causes of anger outbursts?
Well, anger is about protection. So most people, if you're feeling threatened, anger is a natural response to having your boundaries crossed. But sometimes when we're not comfortable with feeling vulnerable or exposed, or, you know, sometimes anger is obviously appropriate. But if we're not used to that feeling, then anger flares up as a natural response and we react to the anger, and some people react aggressively or violently.
Wow, a form of protection.
Right.
Wow. And women go through crazy menstrual cycles every month, and their anger reactions are quite nuclear. Even though it's hormonal, are there ways that we can deal with it better?
Sure. So obviously, the more we learn to be with our feelings, not anyone, the more comfortable you become with being with your anger and your vulnerability, the less, even though it is a chemical, the less it would impact you. So you chose to, for example, so some people are more sensitive, and so their emotions would affect them more. So the more comfortable you are, it will be important for those people to be more self-reflective and become comfortable with their emotions, so that their hormones don't impact them so much.
Those people, namely women. Now, Roxy and Riky, you mentioned earlier, we were talking about family values earlier, and we know that the people we love the most and closest to us can test us the most. And you said that you were teaching yourself patience. What are some of the lessons that you've learned about handling your anger?
For me, it's like patience, and like I've tried to lessen my expectations, you know what I mean? Like I've tried to not have my way the whole time, you know what I mean? And like, when I lessen my expectations, I don't wanna, you know, go crazy when somebody doesn't do what I want them to do. So it's a bit better for me that way.
And Roxy, you come from a big family, and siblings test each other's patience.
Oh yeah, we four, so we're always testing each other. but yeah, I suppose anger, I mean, I'm active, so I somehow get my frustrations out, I suppose, in the gym.
Yeah, you look like yoga. You never get angry, darling.
I do.
She's so chilled.
Now, Warren, how do I know when I now need help managing my anger?
Well, I think most people, it would be a good idea to learn how to become self-aware.
Okay.
Self-awareness is important.
Okay.
If the moment gets to a violence, or you're aggressive and you want to get out and punch someone,
right,
I would say that you're already beyond the point of, you should have looked for help before.
Sure.
So I don't think it's about when is the best time to look for that. I think it should be part of learning.
Okay. Like,
to learn about who we are, it should be part of that philosophy of going, well, it's important for me to understand myself, and maybe I should learn about my emotions. How do I learn about that? Maybe it is through finding a therapist, or maybe it is through yoga, or something that we become self-reflective, because our emotions are driving our behavior. So if we're not in touch with that, who's in control?
Is it ever good for me to express my anger? When is it okay?
Well, anger can be expressed destructively and constructively, right? So if you feel angry and you go for a run, that's way better than punching your boyfriend, you know?
Yeah.
Or if you go to the gym and you vent all your anger into an exercise, you're getting fit at the same time while you're angry.
Right.
So it has it's called sublimation, and it has a positive impact on you.
Right.
Screaming and shouting, maybe when there's no one around or you're not actually attacking someone.
Someone.
Yeah.
Right. What are some of the tools that I need to help me manage my anger in a constructive way?
I would suggest that you find out what triggers you.
Okay.
Once you can identify what triggers you and you can begin to then identify all the situations will bring your awareness up.
And obviously the situations differ, so I need to find out what the underlying trigger is, right?
The underlying trigger is...
Again, yes, protection.
Usually right. About vulnerability.
Defense.
Right, so it's a defense. So, but if you can become aware of how comfortable are you, what is the situation showing you? Is it showing you your vulnerability? If it's showing you your vulnerability, is there something you can learn about that? Is it just about allowing yourself to feel what you're feeling?
Mm-hmm.
And then maybe realizing, oh, I don't need to attack this person. Or has this person crossed over an actual boundary where it is appropriate to say, excuse me, step back?
Wow, yeah. And I also remember something you shared with us on an earlier show, that even when I feel vulnerable, it's good for me to sit in it. And just experience it.
It's part of who we are.
Yeah.
We can't get away from that.
Yeah.
We can try, but...
Thank you,
Warren. Not going to get far. You're welcome.
So, there is help out there to manage our anger. So don't allow it to control you any longer. And don't feel that you're alone. Many South Africans experience anger outbursts. Just find a healthy way of dealing with it.
Thank you so much, Bonnie. Today on the show, as you all know, we're celebrating awesome families and family values. And every awesome family has an awesome pet. And most of the time, the pet is a dog. So all the way from Canine Concepts, we do have Claire here, who's going to be telling us a little bit more about the Tellington T-Touch method, which is a form of body work that helps to stimulate and activate the nervous system on a dog's skin. Welcome to Afternoon Express. Lovely to have you. Of course, the name says it all, Claire, you know, T-Touch. But how does the method work?
The name T-Touch actually comes from Linda Tellington Jones, who developed it, the T-Touch method. But basically the T-Touch is all about moving the body and the skin in non-habitual movements that the animal is not used to.
Okay.
And when you move the animal's skin or limbs, ears or tails, in a non-habitual way, which means a way that they're not used to, the nervous system actually pays attention to that.
And
when the nervous system pays attention to that, then you open unused neural pathways, which can actually lead to better behaviors.
And obviously, is the method all over the body, the head,
it's
the
all
leg,
over the
limbs?
Body, from the nose right down to the tail. You can work inside the gums. We actually work inside the mouth for aggression issues. We work on the ears a lot to help dogs calm down. Dogs that have gone into shock, we'll work on the ears quite a bit there.
So it's just small touches all over the body.
Small circular touches, and they've actually done some studies where your circle and a quarter touch actually has the most beneficial effect on the animal. Yeah. So you want to do a circle and a quarter, have a stop, and then we just slide down to the next spot.
Okay.
So each circle and a quarter is a touch in itself.
Fantastic. And why do you then add, you know, the obstacles? What do those do for the animal?
Obstacles help to slow the animal's thinking down a little bit because everything in their life is so rushed. It makes the nervous system work slower, it makes the muscular system work slower, and it kind of forces the animal to pay attention to what they're actually doing with their body.
Fantastic, then walk us through. Do we start this way?
We'll go over this one.
If anything happens, darling, I need you to catch me. Okay. All right.
Okay. So even though the obstacles look really low and simple, you can see he's actually battling now with the slippery surface, right?
Okay.
That means he's not aware of actually where he's placing his feet.
Okay.
And then when we lead him over the different surfaces, this actually helps to increase the proprioception.
Okay.
And proprioception has to do with your awareness of where your body is in space and time.
We'll come this way,
And when you increase your proprioception, you also increase your dopamine levels in the body.
Okay.
All right.
Oh, fantastic.
So just feeling different surfaces underneath his paws actually increases the dopamine in the body.
Okay. So let's see if we can do that again. The obstacles. This is fun, Bamla. Come. Let's do it again.
So can we go from this side?
Mm-hmm. Come, Emil. Come, darling.
They're a bit high.
Okay.
There we go.
And how long would you then do the obstacles for, Claire?
You will do as long as what the animal can handle, sometimes 5 minutes, sometimes 10 minutes. It all depends on the dog. Uh-huh. So you would always take your direction from what the dog can actually deal with.
Fantastic. Mm-hmm. All right. Well, there you go. You learn something new every single day right here on Afternoon Express. Amir, I'm so sorry, darling. Won't happen again. We're done. We're sorry. Thank you so much, Claire.
Thank you
from
so much
K&M Concert for coming through and telling us about the Tellington Tea Touch Method. If you want more information, of course, it's all on our website. Tag us right now at Afternoon Chat using our official hashtag Afternoon Express. Don't go anywhere. After the break, John Savage and Robin Fearon are in the loft to tell us about their brand new hit comedy. Yes, Stone Cold Jane Austen. Stay with us.
Sit. Oh. Good boy.
Beano, keep their tails wagging.
Welcome back to Afternoon Express on SABC3. Thank you so much for staying with us. I have a feeling it's about to be a laugh a minute. Now, I'm very excited about this. It has just been released in cinemas nationwide and is definitely South Africa's most rocking comedy to date. It's called Stone Cold Jane Austen and follows the trials and tribulations of a fictional local rock band trying to revive their career by releasing an Afrikaans album. And joining us today is the director, writer and star of the film, John Savage. And with him is one of South Africa's best loved comedians and his co-star, Rob van Vieren. Gentlemen,
you've
lovely
got
to have you.
There.
Okay.
The star.
Thank you.
Let's talk about the star. Now you...
I'm just trying to sit like you sit and I'm finding it incredibly difficult.
I know, it's a very
you
difficult
must have
position.
Such a very strong call because this is hard.
And I do this all day.
You make it look so natural.
Hour, like,
ask me a question.
Yes, Rob. Now you play Karl, right?
Yes.
Which is one of the members of the rock band.
Uh-huh.
And John, you play Johnny. Let's talk about, you know, the idea around this comedy and what it's all about for somebody that's watching at home and doesn't know anything about it.
Jeez, where do you start, John? Where did you start?
I think you missed one. The main part of the premise is that this...
He's already directing you.
Yeah, this, of course. I'm already correcting my sentences.
It's an English-speaking rock band trying to break into the Afrikaans market, but they don't speak Afrikaans. And that's quite an important part.
Yeah. We pretend to be an Afrikaans rock band, but we can't actually speak the language.
Yes, that's essentially. And what's interesting about it is it's something that I think a lot of local bands know intimately. I mean, the story of Stone Cold is really everything that this band does, most of the things, have been done by local bands already.
We are the defenders of Afrikaans language.
I'm English. I'm going to use Afrikaans. I'm going to make a lot of money.
I never stole his moves. I couldn't keep my mouth shut.
It makes South African artists look ridiculous.
Never stole his life.
I don't even know what it means. It's Afrikaans.
People got to believe that we love Afrikaans music.
We love Afrikaans music.
Yes.
We don't even speak Afrikaans.
Yeah, well, I'm learning.
But as the creator and the writer of the film, how did this concept, you know, come to mind? I mean, it is really, really fascinating. After you've said all of that to me, do you remember the moment the idea popped into your head?
This movie came to be because I was in a band called Cassette.
Okay.
They did a documentary about Cassette, which I've never seen because I didn't want to see. It really documented the demise of what was my whole life at that time. And this movie was a reaction to that film. I never wanted to see us, and I made a comedy about this band in a similar situation to Cassette, just trying to keep it together.
Yeah.
So there's quite a lot of truth in it, and I think it's a story that anybody who has a dream that... Mm. Just relentlessly tries to, despite the obstacles, because I remember in my Cassette days, you got your blinkers on, and if you're running in the wrong direction, you don't care. And that's really the premise of this band.
Yeah.
They do everything wrong, but it doesn't stop them.
And that's, funnily enough, exactly how John made this movie. Take it from me, this movie is a mistake.
Really?
It's a giant mistake.
So why did you want to be part of this mistake when you were given the script to please
go? He was like, will you do this? Like, yeah. I'm like, this guy's crazy.
Yeah.
This is never gonna work. And then we shot something and then he's like, okay, we're gonna do it some more. In the beginning, he didn't even know it was a movie. It was like maybe webisodes, maybe a TV pilot. He's like, Rob, we're doing something else. I'm like, sure. And we just kept doing it.
Yeah.
And eventually it somehow became a movie and he's broken. If people ask me, honestly, how was it making this movie? And my honest response is, It's a step-by-step guide of how not to make,
a movie. To make a movie, fantastic.
From beginning to finish, and because of that, it's ironically, like, I think the best work certainly I've done on film. I think it's a really fresh, really interesting, really unique South African movie. You won't have seen anything like it on local screens. And because he broke all the rules and he actually has no idea what he's doing, he's made something really beautiful.
I mean, John, you do have no idea what you're doing, right? And you have Polisikaru, you have Kurt Darren, you have you have Randall from South African Idols all playing cameos in this movie.
Then, and that's only the tip of the iceberg. Like, there's everyone is in this movie.
Then how do you convince them to be part of a mistake?
Well, we didn't tell them it was going to be a mistake. They're only realizing it now, as you are, and all the viewers are, and as Rob has.
So what do you say to Randall? Randall, I'm putting together a movie. Come play a cameo.
You know what? I think in life, you just got to ask people. And I expected no so many times. And there was no reason these people said yes to be in this film, except that they knew that it was a dumb idea and why not.
Yeah.
And I'd actually be, when I was making this film, before this film, I'd been the music director at the Sarmas for a few years. So I'd been, and before that I was in my band and I was on radio. So I knew a lot of the artists already.
Okay.
And I'd kind of asked them to do some stupid things in the past. And when I'd phoned a lot of people, like, you know, from the F*** Off Guys or Jack Parra, they're usually like, okay, John, what do you want this time? What do you want to, what are you going to ask us to do?
Yeah.
And every, I mean, people like Kurt Darren were so generous of their
That's
time.
Amazing.
And even Rob, who literally, like, we shot the pilot 3 years ago. People have just been so generous.
I think it tapped into, like, a real spirit of playfulness and everyone kind of got sucked up in that sense of fun and adventure.
Yeah.
And it's palpable and tangible when you see it on screen. It's a really... I'm so excited about this movie.
Hello, Mr. Darren. So glad you could make it.
Yeah, that works a lot.
This is okay. Kurt Darren, everybody. We're running a very, very tight ship.
I need to have a bit of water.
Sure. We need water for Kurt, please. Mr. Darren, must I cut an answer, I believe, your backtrack here.
Sure.
For Ducky. Thank you very much. Get this to Jonty, quick. Backtrack. It's the backtrack. Thank you very much. There you go.
I need this.
Where's the stage? This is the stage. It's a truck and a stage in one. It's a whole new performance stage. You can actually go in it. It takes you to the location. You just have to pop out and you're going to have a fantastic gig. Good luck. Thank you very much, Mr. Darren.
And talking about budget and asking people, like you said, you ran out of money while you're creating this comedy, and then you say to everybody, hey, can you please, you know, donate some money for the big scenes? How was the response? And, you know, did people give you all the money that you needed?
I was really terrified. And now, I would super recommend... There's something about crowdfunding that is magical. And I got to this dead end where I'd been working on it for years. It was never going to happen. I'd shot this pilot ages ago. I'd try to get all the film finances and the television stations, and no one would return my calls, and no one really wanted to do it. So as a last resort, and in future I would have done this first, I just put it on the internet and said, look, I need help, and here's the pilot, and would anybody help?
Sure.
And I didn't know what to expect, but I was really blown away. And it wasn't only... The money that we got was a small part of it, because it actually gave the whole thing life. And people were like, I can't contribute. There was one dude who said to me, I want to be a part of your film. I can't give you any money. How many retweets of your trailer to get a part in the film? And then
Incredible.
I said, okay, 100. Which I thought, no, you can't get 100 retweets. By the end of the day, he had 100 retweets of my trailer.
And
we wrote him into the movie. It was the bouncer in the opikopi scene. I mean, all respect, he's a terrible actor. But he's in the movie. And I think it was part of the collaboration of this film. If you don't have budget, you need help.
Yeah, you do.
So I opened the doors to anyone to say, like, if you can help us in any way, be a part of it. And it was the best thing I've ever done. I really thought that's an amazing thing.
And did you expect it to be received at the Cannes Film Festival?
Well, I've got to be honest. I had no... when we got the call, I was amazed. My brain is literally... still smoking.
That's amazing.
From that, I mean, what a buzz to be selected to go to Cannes is just incredible, and we can't believe the response that it's had is unfathomable.
It is unfathomable, especially if you see the film.
Yeah. Well, I can't wait to watch it. Well, I'd like to introduce our very first Afternoon Express Movie Awards. We've got something special for both of you because we absolutely love you. First up, Werner's going to come through for the best actor in a South African film.
That is
Rob van Vier.
Awesome. I can't
there you
second
go.
That because Rob is amazing in this film.
Is and this Werner?
That is Werner. And our favourite director in a South African film, Mr. John Savage.
This is so long overdue. I'm upset of how long it took to get one of these.
Exactly. Thank well, do you have a little thank you message
yes.
you want to say to anybody?
I'd like to say a speech. I just want to say that awards mean nothing to me. Okay? I'm keeping this one, but they mean nothing to me. What really counts is you people at home. Go watch this movie.
Yes.
Okay? South African cinema cannot exist if you don't go watch the movies. Mm. Please. This is a cool movie. It's the best movie I've ever done. I'm very excited. Please watch it. Please support it. I love you. Thank you, Mom.
I have a newborn child that really needs to eat. New Metro Cinemas right now.
Well, there you go. John Savage and Rob van Vuuren in our lounge. Make sure you go out, like they said, and support South African productions in selected cinemas all across the nation. Stone Cold Jane Austen. Thank you, gentlemen, so
you.
Very much.
Thanks
I can't wait
us.
To watch it. It definitely is rocking. Something that I hope is not a mistake is what Bonnie is making in the kitchen right now with Marli.
Thanks, B. Rob and John are absolutely hilarious, and there are no mistakes in this kitchen. Now, Marli, Afternoon Express crowns you the official dessert
Thank
queen.
You.
I mean, these figs look so gorgeous. They're golden and the sugar's caramelized.
They're just right.
I know, right? Yeah. So now we're about to make the amaretto cream.
Yeah. This okay. is the decadent part of the dessert. Mm-hmm. So we are going to take some double thick cream, okay. Some mascarpone.
Yummy.
We're going to add all in a bowl, sweeten it with some sugar, okay. and then The liqueur. Yeah. This is amaretto liqueur. And amaretto liqueur is, you can have you get that nice almond flavour coming
right.
through.
It smells like marzipan.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. So amaretto means little bitter in Italian.
Little bitter.
So it's just a little bit bitter. So not too bitter, not too sweet, just really...
Only the Italians can make bitterness sound sexy.
So we're just going to mix, and you can see that this is full of fat.
Yes, I think yes. A lifetime on the head, that's how we do it.
We're going to add some, you can carry
add
on with that.
All this.
Yeah, we'll
okay.
add some sugar in.
Right.
And then the liqueur goes in as well. And it's really quick. So we just whisk it together. Now, if you have somebody who doesn't like alcohol, it's
okay.
quite easy. Yeah. I've got some amaretto biscuits here as well.
As one doesn't,
so
really likes alcohol.
You add that in and you let it stand and it gives the same flavour.
Okay.
And if you don't want to add the cream, quite sad, but if you want to
what else
that
can
out,
you, yeah.
Some plain yogurt. So
some
get the Bulgarian,
yogurt.
The double thick yogurt,
yes, lots of
and you
fun
do the same with this, yeah.
And of course you'll find all the details on our website, www.afternoonexpress.co.za.
Okay, do you want to give it just
yes.
give it a good whisk? I think that looks great. And if there's some of that
okay.
orange zest left over from earlier,
mm-hmm.
that can also go in here,
go
or
in
you
there.
Just use it to garnish
okay.
afterwards.
I mean, how smooth do I need to get this consistency?
That's perfect. That's perfect.
Is this perfect?
If you overbeat it, you'll make butter. So that's absolutely perfect like that.
Okay, cool.
And you leave
What's
it in
next?
The fridge until it's ready.
Leave it in the fridge.
Yeah, and that's the cream.
Awesome. While we pop that in the fridge, after the break, Riky Rick performs for us.
Welcome back to Afternoon Express on SABC3. We're very excited to have him in the loft today, performing a brand new single featuring Zano. It's titled Sondela. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Riky Rick.
This one's dedicated to the lovers. Family values out now. Make sure you get them. All peace and love. Yes.
All I care about was the money.
Oh, yes. Cause
getting hurt by love wasn't funny.
Yes.
But I never thought,
yes.
never with my wildest dreams,
oh, yeah.
that I would find someone.
Everybody at home, it's very simple.
Like you.
We go Sunday.
Sondela,
yes,
Sondela,
yes, Sondela, Sondela,
Sondela.
It's very easy, just
Sondela, Sondela,
yes,
Sondela,
yes,
Sondela.
I love your voice, by the way.
Sondela.
I love your voice. Check it out, let's do it like this. Baby. I just wanna put a smile on your face. I just wanna let you know you a mace. I just wanna let you know, baby, you're driving me crazy. When I'm with you, I just can't behave. Somebody's so beautiful. So many things I wanna do to you. Your high class, so patience is nothing new to you. Your high class, so ain't nobody can get it. And if they tryna holler, then tell these niggas forget it. Cause you're mine. Girl, I never leave you behind. Cause you're mine. You the only one on my mind. Baby, you're mine. See, baby, you're the only one that I need. I ain't tryna mess around, I'm tryna make you believe. Cause you're mine. Yes, baby, you the best that I had. Cause you're mine. I love you cause you made me a dad. Baby, you're mine. I'm sorry for the times that I'm bad. And I cherish all the time that we have. I love you deeply, baby, baby.
All I care about was the money, 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 money.
Oh yeah.
Cause getting hurt by love wasn't funny, funny, funny.
Such a beautiful
funny.
Voice. Such a beautiful voice.
But I never thought,
yes.
Never in my wildest dreams.
Oh yeah.
That I would find someone.
Everybody at home,
like
it's very simple,
you.
Just
luckiest woman in the world. Riky Rick and Zanoh right here on Afternoon Express. But I have to ask you how it was collabing with Riky on this one.
Yeah, I mean, something very different and something that I've been looking forward to, you know, just finding the right person to do it with and breaking out of the house music space. I want to be known as a vocalist, period.
Yes.
Not a house music vocalist. So when Riky came through, and I mean, Ricky's hook game is hella.
That's
put pressure
true.
On me to write a good chorus, so it was just great.
You really did a good job. So
thank you very
much. Sang for your dinner, come through this way.
I can't think of a better way to end off such a lovely show on family values than with all the sweetness. Thank you, Marli.
You're welcome. Enjoy.
Marli, thank you so much for, you know, putting all of this together. I'm going to say everybody dig in, dig in, dig in. Rob and John, thank you very much. Congratulations on Khan, and you know, hopefully this movie is a huge success.
It is. It thank is already. You. Thank you so much. We're very excited.
Hey, Rox, what's next for you?
Well, I've just started doing triathlon. So
triathlon.
No, I did my first one recently, and we'll see where that goes.
All right, well, take it away. There you go.
Thank you.
All right, don't forget, you can get all of these yummy, yummy ingredients. And, of course, the recipe on our website, www.afternoonexpress.co.za. From myself and Bonnie, thank you so much for joining us right here on SABC3. We're back on your TVs tomorrow. So good night.
And happy eating.
Cheers. Good night. Take it away.
Tomorrow on Afternoon Express, it's all about Italian cheese in the kitchen. We chat to Afrikaans electronic band, the Hebels Fantasties. Rosette Mwana talks about married life. Fashion designer Stefan Martin shows us his latest line. Hairstylist Sean Adams shares some easy tips. And we get the ins and outs of the child modeling industry.
Another feel-good production.
Join us next time for more fabulous fun inspired by First for Women on Afternoon Express. For an insurance quote, call 0861 11 1844 or SMS FIRST to 49267.